Amen. All right, so the meat of the sermon is going to be located here in Daniel chapter number 3. I'm going to be preaching on the three Hebrew children by name Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But turn over to Daniel chapter number 1. We'll get over to Daniel chapter number 3 in just a moment. But there's a lot of like pertinent details about the character of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that we get from Daniel chapter number 1. They're really only mentioned in Daniel 1 and in Daniel chapter number 3. So we'll begin here in Daniel chapter number 1, right in verse number 1. The Bible says, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. Remember, I preached on understanding the Bible a couple of weeks back, and one of the real important details about understanding the Bible is context, and we get the context of what time period this is taking place right now. So if you don't remember, Jehoiakim, his name originally was Eliakim, I believe. Eliakim, I know he was the brother of Jehoahaz. And Jehoahaz was taken captive by Pharaoh Necho at the end. This is taking place before Zedekiah was king. So Jehoiakim actually took over because Jehoahaz was taken. And Pharaoh Necho changed his name to Jehoiakim. So he was reigning. And while he was reigning, after they had already been attacked by Egypt because Israel was in sin, that's when Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon came, and they took everything, and they didn't completely, you know, lay the city desolate yet. That was years later when Zedekiah started reigning, because they continually hardened their neck and hardened their heart at that point when God had already told them, hey, this destruction is coming because of your disobedience. Mm-hmm. And then they didn't submit under the hand of Nebuchadnezzar. And what happened was Nebuchadnezzar came back in a second time when they tried to rebel and just destroyed the city and took basically everybody away. At this point, the Bible tells you that in the beginning, the first time that he came, that he only took away basically the higher class. The people that were the educated, the people that were, you know, so that would be a lot of like the scribes and the rulers. Now, at the time of Christ, a lot of those people were complete, you know, heretics, and they were just completely in apostasy. But at this point, a lot of them were still serving God. So look into verse number 1 more time. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, so Jehoiakim had been reigning, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem, and besieged it. Verse number 2, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar, to the house of his God. And he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel, and of the king's seed, and of the princes. So notice this is the higher class, like I said. Verse number 4, children in whom was no blemish, but well-favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. Verse number 5, and the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. It tells you in verse number 6, Now among these were of the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Those are their Hebrew names. Now that is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And in just a moment, the very next verse, the following verse, he actually tells you who is who. So look at verse number 7. Unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names. For he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, not to be confused with Belshazzar. That was Nebuchadnezzar's grandson. So Belteshazzar, and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. So it just told you just a moment ago that they were going to learn the tongue of the Chaldeans, so the language of the Chaldeans. These other names that they're given are names that would be in Chaldea, a Chaldean name. Now look at verse number 7 one more time, just a way that I use to memorize which is which. So notice Shadrach, it says that he gave, or it said, I'm sorry, so Hananiah is Shadrach. And then Mishael is Meshach, and to Azariah is Abednego. Now notice, 2 out of 3 of the names of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego start with the same letter. It's just an easy way to be able to memorize who is who in the Bible. Azariah is Abednego, And then Mishael, that's his Hebrew name, is Meshach. Most people, if you grew up in church at all, or you know, if you ever went to church maybe with your grandparents or anything, you've probably heard of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So if you memorize Mishael, Azariah, and Hananiah, it's real easy to put the two together, because the only one that you would have any kind of trouble with would be Hananiah. Because that one is Shadrach. That one's the one that it doesn't start with the same letter. And I'm sure these languages were probably, you know, connected in some way. They probably derived from, you know, the same branch of languages is why it's similar. Now, I want you to turn over to Exodus chapter number 31, verse number 3. Try to keep your hand there if you didn't drop it yet. But because we're going to keep going back there. Because that's basically going to be our text, Daniel chapter 1. And then Daniel chapter number 3. And now I'm going to read you again from Daniel chapter number 1 there, something that it said in verse number 4. Children in whom was no blemish, but well favored. Now I want you to pay attention closely to the point that it's trying to get across. And skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace. And then it says, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. Now, many people, and many independent Baptists especially, but even Christians in general, they try to de-emphasize the importance of learning and getting smarter. And independent Baptists are really bad about this. They just try to act like the only thing that you need to know is things out of the Bible, and that no other knowledge is important. Now here, don't get me wrong, the foundation of all wisdom is the Bible. Right. God's Word is where all wisdom and all knowledge starts. And basically everything that you could learn in the world, no, there is something in the Bible that you could be taught about it. And that you can at least start here, of course. And of course, if you're going to spend your time reading books, I love to read. If you're going to spend your time reading books, you should read this book first, and then if you have another book you want to read, read it afterwards. But the Bible emphasizes that you need to spend time, and you should be interested in learning, and you should be interested in growing in wisdom and in knowledge. And a lot of people just try to act like, and the more ignorant our society gets year by year, and the dumber that everybody becomes, the more they try to de-emphasize this, and the more they try to act like, you know, that it's not important. But the Bible's real clear. You know, the people that have wisdom, they live in all areas. It's not only spiritual wisdom. That's the point I want to get across right now. They live a happy life. They live a prosperous life in all ways. I'm not saying just a rich life. I'm not referring to just wealth, but just a prosperous, a good life in all areas. The Bible's very clear that the Bible says if you reject wisdom, that you will destroy your life. That you will destroy your life. Look at Exodus chapter number 31, though, verse number 3. So we'll read verse number 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, see, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. Now watch what it says. This is God speaking. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge. Now watch this. And in all manner of workmanship. Verse number 4, to devise cunning works, to work in gold and in silver and in brass and in cunning and in cutting of stones, to set them and in carving of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship. Now this is something that somebody would probably say, if you brought it up to them, that would be maybe considered secular, or that would be maybe, it's obviously something that most people wouldn't think of, that would be a knowledge or a wisdom that would come from God. But the Bible says, God says specifically here, that he filled Bezalel with the Spirit, that he was the one that gave him the knowledge and the wisdom and the understanding to be able to do this type of work. This would be something that you would think, hey, God, this is outside of God's realm. There's nothing outside of God's realm. Right. Turn to 1 Kings chapter number 4, we'll see this again. The most wise man that ever lived, obviously outside of Jesus Christ, the person that we think of in the Bible that would be, you know, the most wise man would be Solomon. So look at 1 Kings chapter number 4. When it talks about the wisdom that Solomon had. Because what God can give you, and what happens is, because you wonder like, hey, if these things aren't in the Bible, then how do you learn them? Well, number one, like I said before, the wisdom, just the foundation of wisdom is the Bible. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. But what happens when you study and you read the Bible, it gives you an understanding heart. Now, if you use that as your foundation and you use that as your basis, and then you go out and then you try to learn other trades, you go out and you try to learn other things about, you know, the world, you're just going to have an understanding heart. God's Spirit will fill you with an understanding heart from His Word. And then when you study these other subjects, God's Spirit is what allows you to be able to understand these things. Because you already have that wisdom and that foundation from God. Look at 1 Kings chapter number 4, verse number 29. We'll see this again. The Bible actually teaches this very clearly. Verse number 29, and God gave Solomon wisdom and understanding exceeding much and largeness of heart. So God is the one that gave this to him. Even as the sand that is on the seashore. Verse 30, and Solomon's wisdom excelled in the wisdom of all children of the east country and all the wisdom of Egypt. For he was wiser than all men, than Ethan the Ezraite and Heman and Chokol and Darda, the sons of Mahol, and his fame was in all nations round about. And he spake 3,000 proverbs, and his songs were 1,005. Now stop and think about this right now. Obviously, we have some of those. We don't have all of them because they all, I don't believe, were inspired by God. Everything that was supposed to be in the Bible, we have. God promised to preserve His Word. Now, He wrote these proverbs. Now, look at verse number 33. It says, and he spake of trees from the cedar tree. So this is something else that he did. But notice it's put into the same category as the Proverbs that he spoke about his wisdom that God specifically gave to him. It says, and he spoke of trees from the cedar tree that is in Lebanon, even unto the hyssop that springeth out of the wall. He spake also of beasts and of fowl and of creeping things and of fishes. And there came of all people to hear the wisdom of Solomon from all kings of the earth which had heard of his wisdom. So it tells you that God is the one that filled Bezalel with the spirit of understanding and knowledge and wisdom. And then it told you what he did. And it was that he was an artificer, like the Bible refers to that as. He was a worker, he was a smith or a blacksmith. He was able to not only be a blacksmith and a smith, he was also able, and he worked in carvings and wood and all, I'm sure all types of detailed tapestry and things like that. So he had a skill that God had given him of something that would be considered out that a lot of people would just think, well, that's just outside of the realm of God. And we see also that God is emphasizing these things. It's, God is telling you that Solomon, the wisdom that he gave to Solomon, was greater than all of Egypt and all of the men of the east. He's trying to show you that this is a good thing. Then when he tells you of his wisdom, he talks about the Proverbs. Yes, and that's the first thing that he mentioned. So that's the most important. That's what you can take away from that. Learning the Bible is where that it starts. That's the most important thing. But then he also talks about secular things. Things that you would consider that are outside of the Bible. Other knowledge just in general is very important, and God wants you to seek knowledge. The Bible over and over again in the book of Proverbs tells you how important and that you should seek for it as hid treasure, that you should seek for it as gold. You know, we shouldn't de-emphasize learning. We shouldn't look at learning and look at knowledge and look at wisdom like, hey, I don't want to be some kind of geek. You know, you need to just be interested in reading. You need to be interested in learning. And we see here that that's an aspect, that is a characteristic of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that they were smart men. And we'll see later that God blesses them. Look at we'll read verse number 7 again. Unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. Look at verse number 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Verse number 9, we're going to read down through a couple of verses here. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king who hath appointed your meat and your drink. For why should he see your faces worse liking than the children which are of your sort? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. So what's going on here is the prince of the eunuchs is basically in charge of basically training and preparing these men. You know, he's supposed to be teaching them the tongue of the Chaldeans. They're probably doing other types of, you know, different subjects of learning and things like that. And while he has the charge of them, he's also supposed to be feeding them. And all it tells you about the king's meat and the king's drink, that's all it says, is that it's the king's and that Daniel does not want to defile himself thereby. One thing I want to point out too is in verse number 8, notice it starts off and it says, but Daniel purpose in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat. Now, what does it mean to purpose in his heart? What does it mean to do something on purpose? That's probably the way that we would speak today. That if I did, I would either do something on purpose or I would do something on accident. If I would say that I was doing something on purpose, that means that I thought out what I was doing. That I had already, hey, decided this is what I'm doing. And that's exactly what it's talking about with Daniel. When it says that he purposed in his heart, it's saying that he had already made the decision. That he knew that he was going to be offered this food. He knew he was going to be offered the meat and the drink of the kings. Then he had already made his mind up. He had already purposed in his heart that he's not going to do that. Now, there's obviously something wrong with the meat and the drink. Now, keep your hand here again, and let's go to Leviticus chapter number 11, verse number 43. Leviticus chapter number 11, verse number 43. A lot of people have different interpretations of what they think the king's meat was, but we should allow the Bible to interpret what the food was. Now, the word meat in the Bible, the word meat just means food. That can be proven very clearly when they would offer a meat offering. When God gave the law, some of them were carnal ordinances that are done away today. But God would have them bring what he called a meat offering, and it would just be like flour. So that proves that it's not just like flesh. That's what we would say. When we're speaking of meat today, the Bible actually uses the word flesh. Now, meat, like I said, just means it can be either one. It would be like food. So it could be flesh, or it could be like flour, just anything. Now, look at Leviticus chapter number 11, verse number 43. It says, excuse me, "Ye shall not make yourselves abominable with any creeping thing that creepeth. Neither shall ye make yourselves unclean with them, that ye should be defiled thereby. For I am the Lord your God. Ye shall therefore sanctify yourselves, and ye shall be holy, for I am holy. Neither shall ye defile yourselves with any manner of creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So if we use the Bible's definition, when food is brought up, and God says that you will defile yourself with this food, it's that list of food that everybody likes to bring up, you know, like the atheist, of, you know, the shrimp and different things like that. And when you look at the list of the food that are mentioned, they are all scavengers. And that's, I believe, one of the reasons why God brought that up. Now, if you look, go back, there was also the king's drink that was mentioned. And he referred to it as wine. Go back to Daniel chapter number 1 if you haven't lost your place there yet. Daniel chapter number 1, verse number 8. So it says, "But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat," that's the food, "nor with the wine which he drank." Now, the word wine also in the Bible has two meanings. It can refer to, what it means is this, the definition of the word wine just means juice. Now, that can be alcoholic juice, or that can be juice like what we would refer today as juice. Keep your hand here again, and go to Song of Solomon chapter 8, verse 2. Song of Solomon chapter 8, verse 2. Song of Solomon chapter 8, verse 2. This is the only time the word juice is used in the King James Bible. So you have in verse number 1. We'll just read verse number 2, that's fine. "I would lead thee and bring thee into my mother's house, who would instruct me, I would cause thee to drink of spiced wine of the juice of my pomegranate." So we can see that wine and juice are actually used interchangeable there, that they're synonymous with one another. Now, the way to prove that is the Geneva Bible, which I believe, I don't have when it was translated here, but it was 15, maybe 55, something like that. The Geneva Bible in Song of Solomon chapter 8, verse 2 actually says this, "I will lead thee and bring thee into my mother's house. There thou shalt teach me, and I will cause thee to drink spiced wine and new wine of the pomegranate." So the Geneva Bible actually says wine both times, further proving that this word juice right here just means wine. And when you see the word wine used, it's juice. Now, a person would be ridiculous to think that every time the word wine is wine. It would be like saying that every time the word meat is meat. Like when in the Garden of Eden, when God's talking about them for eating plants and herbs, he says that shall be meat for you. Proving again. So over and over again. So if you just try to take the present day definition and apply it to the King James Bible, you're going to come up with all kinds of, you know, weird things and all kinds of false doctrine. There's words in the Bible that, in the King James Bible, that are a little bit different than what we use today, but they're all in a modern dictionary, and you'll find the definition of this in a modern dictionary today, And if you don't, then you use the Bible as your dictionary, and the Bible will teach you what this means. Now, amen. To further prove that from the Bible, Isaiah chapter, you turn to Lamentations chapter number 2, verse number 11. Isaiah chapter number 65, verse number 8 says this, "Thus saith the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one saith, destroy it not, for a blessing is in it, so will I do for my servant's sake, that I may not destroy them all." So notice what he said there, "as the new wine is found in the cluster." Now, while the juice from the grape is still inside the cluster, is it alcoholic? No, it's not. He says, "as the new wine is found in the cluster," proving that the word wine is used for juice. Now, the Bible's really clear that there are two types of wine. There is no discussion about that. People, the people that want to drink don't believe this, but the Bible is very clear and you can prove it over and over again. Another proof is Lamentations chapter number 2, verse number 11. "Mine eyes do fail with tears, my bowels are troubled, my liver is poured upon the earth, for the destruction of the daughter of my people, because the children and the sucklings swoon in the streets." Is that Lamentations chapter 2? I'm sorry, yeah, I didn't tell you to turn there, that's fine. I just was making sure if you guys had turned there. Lamentations chapter number 2, verse number 11. "Mine eyes do fail with tears, my bowels are troubled, my liver is poured upon the earth, for the destruction of the daughter of my people, because," watch this, "the children and the sucklings swoon in the streets of the city. They say to their mothers," so who's speaking? Who is getting ready to say this? "The children and the sucklings," that's referring to babies. "They say to their mothers, where is corn and wine? When they swooned as the wounded in the streets of the city, when their soul was poured out into their mother's bosom." So notice who's saying, where is the corn and where is the wine? It says that the children and the sucklings are saying that. So in order to believe that wine is always alcoholic, you would have to believe here in Lamentations chapter 2 that these babies are crying out for alcohol, that they're asking for wine, that they want to drink alcohol, which would be ridiculous. Now, obviously, I want you to go back to Daniel chapter number 2, or Daniel chapter number 1. I'm going to read to you from one other passage here about this. To go back to Daniel chapter number 1, get that in one hand. Whoops. Daniel chapter number 1. And then in the book of Daniel, I believe it's Daniel chapter number 10. Get Daniel chapter number 10 in your other hand. So Daniel chapter number 1, he talked that he didn't want to defile himself with the king's meat and with the king's wine. Now look at Daniel chapter number 10, look at verse number 3. "I ate no pleasant bread, neither came flesh," watch this, "nor wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled." Now, obviously, because Daniel just didn't not drink wine. By the Bible's definition, there's obviously something wrong with the king's wine. There's obviously something that's different about this wine, that he's drinking in Daniel chapter number 10, verse number 3, than the wine that's being offered to him in Daniel chapter number 1. And that's because there are two wines in the Bible. Deuteronomy chapter number 32, verse number 31 says this, "For their rock is not as our rock." So there's two different rocks. "For their rock is not as our rock, even our enemies themselves being judges." Watch this. "For their vine," saying in the same way that their rock is not as our rock, he says, "For their vine is of the vine of Sodom and of the fields of Gomorrah. Their grapes are grapes of gall. Their clusters are bitter. Their wine is the poison of dragons." That sounds a lot like alcohol. And then it says, "and the cruel venom of asp." Now a person could say, well, maybe they just didn't. They just thought wine was anything that came from the clusters or anything that came, out of a grape was bad. In that same chapter, in verse number 14, it says this, "butter of kine and milk of sheep, with fat of lambs and rams of the breed of Bashan and goats, with the fat of kidneys of wheat." Now watch this. "With the fat of kidneys of wheat, and thou didst drink the pure blood of the grape." So he says, there's two different types of rocks. They have a different rock than we have. Sounds a lot like the Catholic Church. They say that the rock that they have, you know, that the rock is actually Peter. We say that the rock is Jesus Christ. And when they want to take their communion, what do? They get out alcoholic wine. And what do? We drink the pure blood of the grape. They go and they get the vine of Sodom and the grapes of Gomorrah. Their clusters are bitter. Their clusters are the poison of asp. We drink the pure blood of the grape. And think about this in the first place. This right here actually ties in with that. The pure blood of the grape. What did Jesus Christ say when he actually sat at the Last Supper? He said that wine that he was giving them, that which was grape juice, he said that was the blood of the New Testament, right?
Yeah.
And the Catholic Church they believe the same thing, right? And they actually believe even further in transubstantiation, that they are literally consuming the blood of Christ, like no exaggeration. And they believe that when they drink that is literally Jesus Christ's blood. That is so blasphemous. And not only that, they believe that it's alcoholic. It's what they say that they're consuming is not the pure blood of the grape. It's the vine of Sodom. Now go back to Daniel chapter number 1. If you haven't left there, Daniel chapter number 1. Look at verse number 9 again. Now we'll read down through here and then I'll show you. Now verse number 9. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who hath appointed your meat and your drink. For why should he see your faces worse liking than the children which were of your sort? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. Verse 11. Then said Daniel to Melzar, whom the prince of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenances be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat. And as thou seest, deal with thy servants. So he consented to them in this matter, and proved them 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. Thus Melzar took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink, and gave them pulse. Now notice what happened here. So he said, we're not going to eat the king's meat, and we don't want to drink the king's wine. Just give us, and he said, pulse and water to drink. Pulse is like vegetables. Now, at the end of the 10 days, he said, prove us and see what we look. And it said that they looked fatter in flesh, saying they looked more healthy than the others. This passage is abused by a lot of vegetarians, a lot of vegans, and they try to say that Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were all vegetarians, and the Chaldeans were just ignorant of the health benefits of all of vegetables, and how you should be drinking water and you shouldn't be drinking wine and things like that. Now keep your hand here and turn back again where we were before, to Daniel chapter number 10, verse number 3. And there's actually something that they invented. A man invented, I don't know his name, I don't know much about it, but I know it's really popular, you've probably heard of it before, called the Daniel's Diet. And it's actually a diet that's based on veganism or vegetarianism, one of the two, where they say that that's the way that God wants us to be eating, that God desires for us, and it's actually biblical that we should be eating and just being a vegetarian, that water should be, you know, what all that we drink. Now, obviously, drinking water, there would be nothing wrong with that, but to say that God teaches that we should not be eating flesh is completely and 100% in error. Now, number one, it's a misunderstanding of the Bible, because they don't know what the word meat means, because it's not even referring specifically to flesh. It could be. That's very likely. I believe that it is. I believe that if you could study the word defile, and you go back when it's used to speak about food, it is talking about what the carnal ordinances that God gave them, which are done away with in the New Testament very clearly, of eating certain animals. That God said that they would be defiled if they did so. But people will say that Daniel, they believe that he just perpetually lived like this. That he just all the time ate vegetables and he ate water all the time. This was a miracle that was performed here. God performed a miracle is what took place. And you can actually prove that is not true. You can actually prove from the book of Daniel. Look at Daniel chapter number 10, verse number 3. You can prove that Daniel ate meat after this. What we would consider meat, flesh. Look at verse number 3. I ate no pleasant bread, neither came flesh nor wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all. Now watch this. Till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Now what does that mean? That means for this period of time, he abstained from eating flesh. Mm-hmm. You know what that tells me? That outside of this period of time, outside of the 3 weeks that it's referring to here, that he did eat flesh.
Right.
That he did eat bread. That he did drink wine. That's not alcoholic wine, but juice. That he did do these things. While he was fasting, he abstained from this. Now, it just shows how ignorant people are of the Bible, that they can literally create, you know, the Daniel's diet, and it can become so popular. That's because people are just ignorant of the Bible. This is a perfect example of what I talked about earlier, how all wisdom comes from the Bible. And when people try to get in here, a lot of people that aren't saved, you know, and they don't have the true foundation of wisdom, they're not trusting in God, they're not saved, you know, you can walk away with all kinds of crazy stuff. Now go back to Daniel chapter number 1. We'll finish the chapter real quick. We'll begin reading in verse number 17. As for these 4 children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom. Notice that. In all learning and wisdom. Over and over again it talks about that. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the days that the king had said he should bring them in, then the prince of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king communed with them, and among them all was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king, and in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all his realm. And Daniel continued even unto the first year of King Cyrus. Now turn over to Daniel chapter number 3. Daniel chapter number 3. Now, the Bible, the book of Daniel is primarily, obviously Daniel's the one that authored it. It's primarily about Daniel. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are talking about it in two chapters. In Daniel chapter number 1 and Daniel chapter number 3. An easy way to remember where this story is located is because it's one of the most famous stories in the book of Daniel. And it's in Daniel chapter number 3. And this story is often talked about as the 3 Hebrew children. Now the reason why they're called children, if you would have noticed in verse number 4 of Daniel chapter number 1, it said children in whom was no blemish. So that's not wrong to say that they are the 3 Hebrew children. Now we'll begin reading in Daniel chapter number 3, verse number 1. The Bible says, Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold whose height was 80 cubits. And the breadth thereof 6 cubits. He set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather together the princes, the governors, and the captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and the rulers of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Then the princes and the governors... Get your Bible now. Pay attention. Then the princes, the governors, and captains, the judges, the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces were gathered together under the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then a herald cried aloud. You probably heard of like a town herald. They used to have these people that were like, you know, the basically like the announcer of events when they were taking place in the town. It's like an orator, basically. Then a herald cried aloud, to you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king hath set up. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth shall the same hour be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Therefore at that time when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and all kinds of music, all the people, the nations, and the languages fell down and worshipped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Wherefore at that time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Now keep your hand here and go to Revelation chapter number 3. Revelation chapter number 3. Revelation chapter number 13. Now, Christians throughout history have always went through persecution. And Christians throughout history have always went through tribulation. Always. There's never been a time in history. The Bible, Jesus, while He walked upon this earth, He very clearly told the disciples that the world was going to hate them. And if the world hated Jesus, that the world would hate them. And if the world hated disciples and we're Christians as well, then the world's going to hate us. Yep. And I believe that Daniel chapter number 3 is much more applicable today, though, than it ever has been. Now, there are parallels in the Bible, and God does so specifically. God, I believe, when stories take place, like in Daniel chapter number 3, where King Nebuchadnezzar makes a decree, I'm sure that there were a lot of differences with, here what I'm going to show you in Revelation chapter number 13, where the image of the beast is set up. But I believe when God recorded, you know, all of the details and He chose what He wanted to record about what took place in Daniel chapter number 3, that He specifically included all of the similarities of what took place so that we could see a parallel here in Revelation chapter number 13. Now look in Revelation chapter number 13. Look in verse number... We'll begin reading in verse number 11. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb. And he spake as a dragon, and he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast, which had the wound by a sword and did live. Verse number 15. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak, and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he caused it all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Go back to Daniel chapter number 3. Now there are so many parallels with Daniel chapter number 3, and then the book of Revelation, and what's going to take place at the end time. And I believe that God recorded this story, and He specifically recorded all of the details that were parallels with Revelation chapter number 3 to be an example unto us. That Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego could be an example unto us. And I believe that many people throughout history, people that were persecuted, that were burned at the stake by the Catholic Church, I believe that they looked to the passage of Daniel chapter number 3 for inspiration on what they should do in these types of passages. We sometimes tend to forget that these men were just men. We sometimes tend to forget that they were just, you know, excelled people, but they were just like you and I. They just chose to do the right thing. Now, all the parallels of it being Babylon, you know, this is physical Babylon, literal Babylon of the Old Testament, and in the New Testament we know that it's mystery Babylon of the end times. We have Nebuchadnezzar, who is a perfect picture of the Antichrist, who makes an image. Now, it never says here that the image is of himself, but I personally believe that the image is of himself. One of the reasons why is because here it's called a golden image. And then in Daniel chapter number 3, when Daniel interprets the vision, it says that Nebuchadnezzar was the golden head. I believe that's why he's so angry, because Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow down to him. Now, when we keep reading through here, there's tons of other similarities. Another one is the fact that it was a decree. This was a mandate by the government, which is exactly what's going to take place in the tribulation. When the Antichrist is reigning, he's going to say, like we just read, you either bow down and you worship the image and take the mark of the beast, or you're going to be put to death. And notice he said that it was all, right? It was everyone. Just like this big long list that it says here, then the princes, the governors, the captains, the judges, the treasurers, everyone. He calls it all. Everyone in his kingdom had to do this. They had to bow down to this image. Now if we keep reading, pick back up in verse number 12 in Daniel chapter number 3. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar... Turn around. KK, turn around. Then Nebuchadnezzar in his rage and fury commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if ye be ready, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made? Well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. Now, the word careful there, a lot of people don't really understand exactly what the word careful means. Now, if like my daughter's walking and she's being clumsy, and I say, hey, be careful while you're walking, or be careful while you're going down these steps. What I'm telling her is basically think about what you're doing. Pay attention to what you're doing. That's what it means to show care, to be full of care. When he says, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter, he's saying basically like I don't have to think about this. I'm not thinking whether or not I should or whether or not I shouldn't. He's saying I'm not worried about answering this. I'm not having to sit here and think about whatever I should, what I should and shouldn't say to you. Look at verse number 17. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. And I believe that God recorded this specific story, and he actually has this in the Bible in Daniel chapter number 3, and he has it representing and making it such a clear parallel with the New Testament, because he knew that there would be a lot of Baptists, a lot of saved people, a lot of saved Christians at this time that would not have the courage to stand up and to say what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did here. We have a lot of, not only the pastors, just a lot of people in the pulpit. And now here's the thing, the pastor behind the pulpit, or the people in the pew, the pastor behind the pulpit, there's a lot of blood on the pastor's hands in the churches today, but also the people in the pew, the people that are sitting in the pew, the people that are coming attending the church, they're going to have to stand up and their pastor's not going to be there anymore. They have to have their own strength and they have to make up their own mind. And another area where just Christianity has just completely went off the deep end is they don't realize, in a situation like this, when man's laws conflict with God's laws, what decision to make. That's a perfect example of rightly dividing. And you know what the book of Daniel is about? The book of Daniel, the main stories in the book of Daniel is about rebelling against the government when they try to mandate something that's against what God told you to do. Yeah. There are three major stories that everybody knows about in the book of Daniel. This is one of them right here in Daniel chapter number 3, where they're told, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you must bow down to the image. Then we have the story later on with Daniel. It's the most popular in the Bible, most well known as far as in the book of Daniel, where he's thrown, he's told he's not allowed, you're not allowed to pray to any other god. Right? You're not allowed to ask a petition of any other god, and it's talking about besides Nebuchadnezzar, further proving that I believe this image was of himself. And Daniel just completely rebels against that. And we have a bunch of people today that Christians that are and pastors that are standing up behind the pulpit that are telling their church members that you should just go along with whatever the government tells you to do. Every single thing. Now here's the thing, I'm not telling you to just rebel against everything that government tells you to do. If it doesn't conflict with the Bible and it's not just destroying your life, then I believe that you should do it. The ordinances and everything like that, the Bible says that you should follow. Stupid things like stopping at a stop sign. It's not going to kill you just to stop at the stop sign. The Bible tells you to follow those things. But in the book of Acts, Peter tells them when the chief priests and all of them are persecuting them, and they're telling them you're not supposed to be, we told you not to speak anymore in his name, to preach about Jesus. They said it is better to obey God rather than man. So if the Bible tells me that I should be doing something, and then the government mandates something and says, hey, you're not allowed to do this anymore, I don't care what the government says. I'm going to do it anyways. I'm going to follow what the Bible tells me. I'm going to obey the example of Shadrach, Meshach, Meshach, and Abednego. I'm going to obey the example that the apostles and the disciples set, being thrown out of the city, and then they'll go right back into the city and start preaching the gospel again. Go right back into the temple. I'm going to obey God, and I'm going to follow the example of Daniel when Daniel was thrown into the lion's den. Now notice what he said there, like I read to you before. He said, "We are not careful to answer thee, O king." He's saying, I don't have to think about this. Do you know what that tells me? That he had already thought about it. Just like what Daniel said in Daniel chapter number 1, that he purposed in his heart, that he had already made his mind up. And a lot of Christians today don't even think they're going to have to go through the tribulation. Here's the thing. The doctrine of whether it's after or before the tribulation is not up for discussion. Yep. That's complete and absolute stupidity. What it is it's a doctrine of convenience. Because all of these people that are, like I'm talking about right now, that are too scared to stand up in a situation like this or are just following everything, you know, they're the ones that are up here preaching, hey, you know, you need to follow the government, every single thing that they tell you to do in every area of your life, they're the same people. The reason why they're doing that is because they're afraid. The reason why they're always because they're scared. They're not trusting in God. That's the whole problem. Now, it's just like I said, they believe that we're not going to be going through the tribulation. They believe that there will be no trials or there won't be any persecutions. But watch here, they're brought before Nebuchadnezzar here, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They're brought before Nebuchadnezzar, and they answer to Nebuchadnezzar, "We are not careful to answer thee in this matter." Verse 17, "If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king." Verse 18, but watch what they say. "But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Some people misinterpret this and they'll say that what they're saying in verse number 18, that they're not really sure whether God could deliver them. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, and like verse 17, read it one more time. "If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king." But if not, he's saying, if he doesn't deliver us, he's saying he's able, and if he will, that's great. He's saying, but if he doesn't, he's saying, even if he doesn't deliver us, even if you do want to just throw us in the burning fiery furnace, hey, it's real easy to follow God. It's real easy to keep his commandments when you know God's going to bail you out in the end time. When you know that you're not going to have to go through any trials, tribulations, and persecutions. And like I said, that's why people believe in the pre-trib raptures, because it's like a doctrine of convenience. It's a doctrine where they can just put that out of their mind, where they don't ever have to worry about any type of trouble, any type of trials, any type of persecutions. But the attitude that we should have is, hey, you know, I know the tribulation's coming, and I know there are going to be a lot of people that are put to death. There's going to be souls that are crying from under the altar. And if God isn't able to deliver me, I don't care. I'm not bowing down to the image. I don't care what the government tells me. And all these pastors that are standing up behind the pulpit, and they're telling you, hey, follow whatever the government tells you to do no matter what. The people that aren't saved in their church, the people that aren't saved that hear that, when it comes time and the tribulation comes and the Antichrist and the beast sets up the image, they're damning those souls. And they're going to pay for that, whether it be in this life and God doesn't allow them to make it through the tribulation or whatever, you know, or whether it be rewards taken from them or whatever it may be. But we should have the attitude that whether God delivers us or not, I know that God can deliver me. And if it be so that God does deliver me, that's good. But if not, I won't bow down to your image. You need to already have that purpose in your heart. Now, I don't believe that a Christian would do that in the first place, but do you know what? I do believe that if you do have that attitude, that God will deliver you.
Yeah.
Keep reading in verse number 19. It says, "Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." The word visage there is like how countenance is used often in the Bible. It's saying his countenance was changed, the look upon his face. Like how we would say, you know, the vision, it's talking about his vision, talking about how he looked, was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. "Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 1/7 times more than it was wont to be heated. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, their hosen," that's pants, men wore pants, and always have, "and their hats, and their other garments and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent and the furnace exceeding hot, the flame of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste. Astonished is like astonished. That's our modern word now. And rose up in haste in a hurry and spake and said unto his counselors, did not we cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said unto the king, true, O king. He answered and said, lo, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Now there are many, many prophecies and revelations in the Old Testament of Jesus Christ to come. Tons of them. But this is a very important one. This is a very significant one because it actually gives you the words there. The fourth is like the Son of God. And almost all of the modern versions destroy this verse. They change it to the sons of a God. Like there are many, like it's just Nebuchadnezzar just speaking and saying, talking about like his pagan gods that he worships. A lot of people will use this though where it says, which is the correct reading, the son of God, and say that they believe that Nebuchadnezzar got saved right here. I don't believe that Nebuchadnezzar was saved. I don't believe he ever got saved because later on it shows him worshiping his other images. And people will talk about how when he wrote the letter, you know, how it seemed like Nebuchadnezzar at that point maybe got saved. I don't believe that either because he actually says after that again, refers back to his pagan gods and talks about the spirit of the gods. I don't believe Nebuchadnezzar ever got saved. But this is that's besides the point. This is a very significant passage because like I said, God chooses what to record that comes out of people's mouth. And when Nebuchadnezzar looked in the burning fiery furnace, he saw four men and there was something very different about the fourth. When it says the Son of God, what he's referring to is it looks like God, but it looks like a man. And that's what the Bible's talking about. It defines what the Son of God means in the book of Luke. And it's the fact that God became a man. People are very confused about that. That's what it means. Things bring forth after their own kind. And that's why the Muslims hate the idea so much that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And that's why in their chant they say there's one God. How does it go? And he has no son? Is that what it says? Yeah. There's one God and he has no son. Notice they say there's one God and he has no son. Saying that Jesus Christ is not God. Because they realize if Jesus was the Son of God, Jesus was God. Things bring forth after their own kind. Why he's referred to as the Son of God is referring to his fleshly birth upon this earth when he became a man. So what Nebuchadnezzar means by that, he's saying they all four look like men, but one of them looks like God. That's exactly what he means here when he says that the fourth is like, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Look at verse number 26. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire, and the princes, governors, and captains, and the king's counselors being gathered together saw these men upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was an hair of their head singed, neither were their coats changed, nor the smell of fire had passed on. This is a great picture that when God saves us, because that's Jesus Christ, the Savior, in there with them, that he completely saves you from the fire. There isn't a purgatory and there isn't a time when you're going to be left on, you know, Baptist briars have weird ideas too, where you're going to be left on this earth to go through the tribulation and you're going to have to, you know, endure God's wrath. The Bible's really clear here as a picture of salvation that not even the smell was on them of the fire. And not even a hair of their head was singed, it says. Mm-hmm. In verse number 27, there is no purgatory. We're completely, when God saves us from hell, we are completely saved from hell. There's either two places you're going, and you're either going to one and going to the other. You're not kind of in limbo in between and kind of going to go to both. Now look at verse number 28. Then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who hath sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him and have changed the king's word. Now watch this. And yielded their bodies. They gave up their bodies. That they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, and language which speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. So like Nebuchadnezzar, that's another thing there at the end. Nebuchadnezzar said at the end of verse number 29, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. So he still believes in other gods, but there's no other God that can deliver after this sort. Just because, see, here's the thing. Like, you know, many Mormons believe that you know, believe supposedly, like they say, in Jehovah of the Bible. They believe in the God of Israel, the Old Testament, but they also believe in many other gods. Just believing that Jesus Christ is the highest of all gods doesn't get you into heaven. Yeah. You have to believe that He is the one true God, the creator of the earth, the one Savior. Now, something pretty cool is, over. If you look over in look at verse number 12. That's not right. Look at verse number 14. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if ye be ready, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye shall fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Now watch what he says. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? And then you see it end with Nebuchadnezzar, you know, having to eat his own words, having to put his foot in his mouth. And he says at the very end, it says that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own god. And then he says end of verse number 29, because there is no other god that can deliver after this sort. Now, get in your other hand Matthew chapter number 18. Matthew chapter number 18, it's verse number 20. Matthew chapter number 18, verse number 20. And like I said, when we go through the tribulation, this is a great example for us to look to. And if we were to understand all along that God will deliver us, we know if you trust in God, knowing God has the power to deliver us. That God has the power to deliver us, but if we made up our mind before, and if we purpose in our heart, like Daniel says, or be careful, you know, or not be careful to answer them, we need to have in our mind that we know all along that God is there with us, and we know that God is able to deliver us. He may not choose to, whether He does or not, you know, but at the end of that passage in Daniel chapter number 3, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego received great rewards. And the people that do go through the tribulation and God chooses, you know, by His perfect will, that they should not be delivered as far as from death, they will go to heaven and they will receive great rewards for that. Like the faith chapter, Hebrews chapter number 11 talks about that, that you would receive a better resurrection for yielding your bodies, giving up your bodies. But all along, we need to know that God was there with us, that God is going to be with us through the tribulation. Now look at Matthew chapter number 18, verse number 20, a statement, a very interesting statement that Jesus Christ actually said in verse number 20. He said, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, and then he says this, there am I in the midst. And that's a perfect picture of the statement that Jesus Christ would make years later. Because we see here the three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, taken, and they're trusting in God, they're trusting in Jesus. And we see the God that's going to deliver them, because they say God will deliver us, and then the Son of God shows up, showing Jesus is God. They take him and they throw him in the burning fiery furnace, and then the fourth man appears. Just like Jesus said, that where two or three are gathered together, there am I in the midst of them. So when we go through these trials and tribulations, you know, there's many other people. You know, we're not going to be just spared from the tribulation. The Bible's real clear, immediately after the tribulation of those days. Yeah. You know, that's when Jesus Christ is coming back. So you need to go ahead and make your mind up. That's why it's important. You say, well, what does it matter? Why would it matter whether, you know, it's before the tribulation or after the tribulation? Because you need to purpose in your heart, like Daniel did. You need to already make your mind up and not be careful to answer the old king. You need to know that you're going to tell them when they bring you before and what you're going to say. Now, you know, like I said, no, I don't believe any Christian will ever worship, you know, the beast. The Bible's real clear about that. It's not just my belief. The Bible very, very plainly states that. That those that are written in the Lamb's Book of life will not bow down to the image. But I believe that those that are trusting in God are those that will be delivered. I believe those that are actually trusting in God and have already made up their minds that whatever, either way, you know, whatever trials, tribulations that they face, that they're going to stand for what God tells them and they're not going to compromise, that those are the few and those are the people that will make it to the end of the tribulation. So you need a purpose in your heart. And when you're reading in your Bible about people going through tribulations and persecutions, use these men like Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and even Daniel as an example to help you get through different even trials and tribulations that you go through in your everyday life. So let's bow our heads and have a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father God, we thank you for this day, dear Lord. We thank you for the great examples that can be an inspiration and encouragement to us, dear Lord God. We ask you that you would be with us and that you would give us strength, dear Lord God, and give us, you know, strength in our faith as well, dear Lord, and help us to be able to stand up and to stand up to the King and to tell the King that, you know, we're not going to bow down to his image and that we are going to worship you and we're only going to serve you, dear Lord God. We love you and just be with us, and in Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
All right, let's turn it around.